presentation today will be rather short, and I hope for opening a discussion where we could compare the experience from our respective countries, and I believe we can find many similarities in how World War I has been taught to students in elementary and secondary schools. And in my presentation, I attempted to make an overview from 1918 until present. I was focusing on Slovakia. In this time span, Slovakia was belonging to different countries, from interwar Czechoslovakia, then we will speak about the World War II Slovak state, then again about Czechoslovakia from 1945 to 89 and 93, and then about the development after 1993, when Slovakia became an independent country. I don't attempt to present the complex picture of the narratives in the textbooks, more I would like to focus on particular aspects of textbooks as such. So, we all know the textbooks and the problems of history education. However, before the start of my presentation, I would just like to draw attention to some points. When we speak about history textbooks, we speak about part of historiography, we speak about part of official historiography, which on one hand presents rather schematic and simplified versions of the past, but on the other hand we also know that most probably history textbooks are most read and most widespread part of historiography. Since 19th century, when the history education and the historical research has been institutionalized, we can conclude that teaching about history mainly evolves around teaching about master narratives on national history. So these ethnocentric and state-centric narratives are the core of history teaching since 19th century until present. History teaching produces the images of self. In social science, sometimes we can refer to this as an in-group of us and the others of the different, the out-group. I will later on develop on this concept. School history textbooks are also a media of creating collective identity and collective memory of students together with other media, but it is one of the most important media of creating our collective memory and collective identity. History textbooks provide us certain schemes how to look at the world around us. History textbooks teach us who has been our friend, our enemy, who treated us well, who is our mortal problem. History textbooks claim to provide certain truth about the past, but also to culturally integrate students within their societies. And what is a very important aspect is the fact that history textbooks reflect current political agenda and, to a certain extent, propaganda of the state. They also try to build a positive image of one's own nation by employing the images of its cultural and moral superiority. The others, we will later talk about who are the others, are often characterized as moral traitors on a lower degree of civilizational development. And one aspect which is characteristic of the history textbook is the fact that the interpretations in this textbook change with the change of different political regimes. So, when I research on history textbooks, I do certain steps. The first thing is to analyze the narratives by identifying the nodal points, that means the main events, themes, and topics of representing the past. And we research on our national history textbook in different periods, we will see that also the event as is representing World War I will be differently interpreted in different regimes, and different aspects of this historical phenomenon will be highlighted, while some of them will go into oblivion. And the second thing which might be helpful when trying to analyze the narratives is focusing on what kind of social stereotypes are included in representing us, the in-group, and them, the out-group. And the third thing is how these representations have been changing in different political regimes. So, social science theory help us with the notion of stereotypes, or the concept of stereotypes, and that is what I search for when I deal with the history textbooks. It is agreed that the definition says us from social science theories that stereotypes are generally shared impressions. They are some kind of images, thoughts, concepts existing within certain groups of people about the characters of other groups of people. Stereotypes are very common social phenomena and they actually help us orienting ourselves in the society we live. They also save our time and energy when we try to establish the mental map of the world around us. However, they may become harmful, especially in the periods of social tension. They are spread in society through families, through school education, mass media, public ceremonies, but as well they are also spread through the contacts with the members of the other groups. And research on stereotypes developed in Europe and the United States mainly after World War I, World War II, but also during the Cold War. That means after or during major international conflicts. And I have several concepts that may help us orient ourselves in the narratives of history textbooks. One of them is the mirror image hypothesis by Bronfenbrenner from 1961, which says that content of stereotypes about other groups of people is influenced by mutual political and economic relations existing between different groups of people. This is very important to keep in mind when we read the narratives in the textbooks, to see the motivations lying behind certain representations. Another quite helpful is a social identity theory developed by Teufel and Turner in the 80s, if we want to say it simply, it says that there is a need to protect one's own group by representing a positive image of the members of this group. Now, when we speak about the groups in this context, we will speak about the nations. Another concept was developed by Sheriff, Levine and Campbell, and it's called realistic group conflict theory, and it says that the negative stereotypes are the outcomes of the competition between particular social groups or particular nations, and that I'm sure that it is detectable in every history textbooks that we would be, or let's say the history textbook which is developed around the traditional concept of writing history. Another theory is scapegoating theory by Duckett, which says that the process of creation of negative stereotypes about the other groups of people is based on economic or social instability. So this basically drives us to the fact that when there is some kind of tension in the society, some kind of instability, the members of one social group or one nation are more open to be receiving negative stereotypes about the members of the other group. And then there is a theory which was already developed in 1939, but I found it quite reasonable to use it when we search for the motivation behind the narratives in the textbook. And it's a frustration-aggression displacement theory which says that frustration, social frustration, leads to aggression. And if this aggression cannot react on the real source of the tension, for example, on international economic development, it is often directed against the member of other social groups or other nations in this sense. So these are the things, I think these are the concepts which might help us when we try to deconstruct the stereotypes or the images we are providing in history education and history textbooks. And now I did just a sketchy overview of the narratives in Czechoslovak and Slovak history textbooks. Firstly, I would like to start with one Czechoslovak individual history textbooks. So I think the social and political context is very obvious. Austro-Hungary is disintegrated and Czechoslovakia is established as a new state, and there is certain social and political need to defend the existence of this state, even in history textbooks, even through representations of the past. One thing I would like to point about the interwar history textbooks in Czechoslovakia is the fact that the plurality of the textbooks, that means the wide range of textbooks that were available on the market that time has never been repeated after, because since 1939 it has been always one prescribed textbook used in the school, in particular grade, in particular schools, but interwar period was characteristic by wide range of choices. Alongside the developments in the historiography, By watching this, by reading this textbook, we will come to conclusion that yes, they contain exclusively political, diplomatic, military history. So that is how the history is being described. And when I was focusing on the most important narratives or events or processes which have been presented in connection with Great War, it was the activities of Czechoslovak legions and their impact during the First World War. These legions were made up by Czech and Slovak soldiers serving in the Austro-Hungarian army who deserted during the war and became war However, this was a particularly important moment to stress out because this would help create the image that Czechs and Slovaks stood on the right side, means on the winning side in the war. So this was very, very, very much promoted image, and you learn very little about other military operations, but this is the central narrative which appears in the textbooks. Another thing which has been always very important for the narratives is the breakup of Austria-Hungary, which has been often described in Czech and Slovak context as the prison of the nations. So this is a very important part of narrating the war. And the third thing is, which later disappears from the textbooks, but in the interwar period, the history is seen in this Thomas Carlyle sense that the history is the outcome of the triumph of the great men, so force of the great men, and in this sense it's the triumvirate of Masaryk, Beneš, and Štefánik, who are described as the founders of the state. There are even sort of, especially in case of Masaryk, biblical references in order to show him as a leader who takes the people to the promised land finally after thousands of years of slavery. So these are the nodal points, I would say. And now regarding the images of in-group and out-group, so in-group, who is us, who has the positive quality in the history in the past, it's Czechoslovaks in narrow sense, or the members of the dominant powers and their supporters in a broader sense. They are described as all the educated world, as superior in civilizational, cultural, and of course moral sense in the world. On the other hand, there is the image of the out-group, here are the Germans, and Austrians and Hungarians, who are described as blatant, sophisticated, immoral, wrongful. So these are the images that students get. And the war is represented as a clash of civilizations. Now, when we move to representation of World War II in World War II history textbooks, I'm sorry, I made a mistake, 1939-45, here we again change the social and political context. So the Czechoslovakia was split, the independent Slovakia was established, it was actually under strong influence of Germany, and it was characterized by certain authoritative approaches, and that was also manifested in history education. So the main author of the textbooks was Rabtišek Krušovský. Actually, he graduated from the Babylonian University, and the main identity-forming concepts in his textbooks were Catholicism and Slovak nationalism. And when he describes World War I, you would not find in his book any reference to causes of World War I, or to its development, or to its results. You find certain references in connection to the development of Slovak nations, specifically to fight of Slovaks for achieving their right to have their own nation, yet even the establishment of Czechoslovakia is not seen as the ultimate good in this sense. There is a lot of images of martyrdom, of heroism, and of course Slovak political and military activities leading towards their independence from Austria-Hungary. There is also a shift in in-group, out-group representation paradigm during World War II. So in-group is not anymore Czechoslovaks. Czechs don't belong anymore to this category for obvious political reasons. So it's solely Slovaks who are described as martyrs, as heroes. On the other hand, there are all the enemies, it's Czechs. Nowadays they shift to the category of enemy as a power which has been preventing Slovaks from exercising their right for an independent national life. It's still Hungarians, though the description of Hungarians is slightly different than that of interwar period, since the two countries still belonged to some same political bloc. There is a complete change in the description of the Germans. Germans became a kind of civilizational superpower that is supposed to be watched towards, and we even get some kind of small references to Jewish population, again in a negative, in the outgroup sense. And there was also the new interpretation regarding the establishment of Czechoslovakia of 1918, when the textbooks claimed that Entente powers were protecting their own aims and they wanted to have the newly established state, Czechoslovakia, just supporting them against Germany. So there is this kind of shift in the interpretation of the whole World War outcomes. Now, when we speak about the period of 1948-1989, here it is necessary to say that it was Marxist historiography which was influencing the narratives in history textbooks, and no alternatives were available. In comparison to, let's say, interwar textbooks, now the authors would put inside also some social economic aspects of World War I, which were represented alongside the political and military aspects of the war. World War I was depicted as the outcome of the wrongful imperialistic and colonial policies of the great powers. And again, World War I was interpreted in close relation with the establishment of Czechoslovakia, which was seen as positive. Less attention was paid to great men, since these were seen as representatives of national bourgeois, and it was not an image to be promoted through Marxist historiography. And then, after 1993, we again get a different situation, Slovak historiography searches for its new models of representation of past. It can be concluded that World War I was never a problem of big controversy. It was World War II that was polarizing Slovak historical society, but World War I was, as we mentioned today, more times overshadowed by the World War II. So it doesn't play a crucial importance in the narrative. What is being interesting is that slowly the textbooks start to also incorporate some kind of social history, a little bit of cultural history, not in big extent yet, but there is some kind of attempt for a neutral political narratives and so on. One specific case was an auxiliary textbook. Auxiliary means it was not a regular textbook, but a textbook produced in 1995. Was very controversial one. It's more chronicle, which has been delivered to every school and to every student. It was basically not textbook approved by the respective committees of historians. So this was a kind of political one-party agenda to promote certain textbooks with certain narratives. And this, it was, I don't want to go into details, but this was one of the textbooks which we can say that it was reflecting this World War II narratives, and it also put World War I into oblivion. So that was a specific example. This textbook was in use for 2 years, then it caused great controversy and it was removed from history education. But there was this kind of, let's say, revisionist approach as well. However, just to conclude, I tried to show, in a very sketchy way, that even such historical process as World War I can be represented, or has been represented in different regimes in different ways. And also the representation of the relation to the others has the in-groups and the out-groups change with different political regimes. So these representations of us and them are always influenced by mutual political and economic relations existing between the nations during the times of writing or using the particular textbook. And this might be actually leading more to a question how we see the history education and history textbooks today. Do we still want them to promote the values of the 19th century, the ethnocentrist approach to past, when we started to institutionalize history education? Do we see them as a part of commemorative culture? Do we see them as serving as the source of the truth about the past, which anyway will need to be rewritten with every political change? Or on the other hand, do we see the history education and history textbooks as tools for educating responsible citizens and building open society? And if yes, then how shall we approach teaching about the Great War so we wouldn't need to change the narrative which we teach political education? So that's all for